I'm Sri Kumar from the Communications and New Media Department at the National University of Singapore, and I'll be presenting on a new representation that I found useful for representing Gamakas of Carnatic music. And firstly, I thank Dr. Sarah and the Comp Music Group for the opportunity to present here, and the amazing hospitality of organized by Dr. Boskut as well. So I just start. So as an overview, I use the regular pattern. I mean, I'll discuss some of the related work in different areas, not just in Carnatic music, that are relevant to the kinds of computational problem that we need to solve in order to model Gamakas. And I discuss the approach that I take, which is somewhat different because it's based on synthesis, and share some of the results that I found. So Mr. Subramaniam gave a really nice intro to the whole topic this morning, so I canceled many of the slides that I had prepared for the intro. So as we know, the Gamakas are the characteristic melodic unit in Carnatic music, and there's sort of a feeling, an intuitive understanding of the logic of Gamakas by musicians, and that's my core interest, and how do you understand these Gamakas through synthesis. So here's a kind of a pictorial view of the spectrum of detail. At the top is what you would normally find in notation systems that are in use. And the graph indicates the Gamakas. So we are trying to bridge, that's the gap that we are trying to bridge. Mr. Subramaniam's Gayaka program as well, it tries to bridge that gap in synthesis. And that's one way to approach understanding Gamakas. So, in terms of related work, of course, Gayaka, which he presented to you this afternoon, that primarily treats Gamakas using textual concatenation principles, and there's work in jazz chord progression, melody generation from jazz chord progressions, which is a completely different topic, but the computational techniques are interesting because they use grammars, which was one of my first attempts to do it. I ran into a lot of problems which forced me to change my approach later on. Regarding the Gamaka contours themselves, the speech intonation research, they have come up with many models, such as the Fujisaki dynamic model and the tilt intonation scheme and maximum-based descriptions, which provide various parameterizations for the pitch contours seen in speech. And recently, Bezier splines have also been used for Gamakas in Hindustani music. And the Musaidig system for singing synthesis, the KTH, they use and they model vibrato and coloratura using similar principles as well, borrowed from the speech world. So the question is that we see in studying Carnatic music, what we find is that the melodic and the shape aspects of Gamakas have different kinds of influences on with respect to that logic. So given that we have been using linear representations as in a single line, we treat Gamakas as a single line in its entirety, we don't yet know how to parse them into these different aspects and what might constitute the melodic part of it or what might constitute the shape aspect of it. And this problem manifests at its best in interpretation of prescriptive notation, of which Gayaka is the only attempt to date. So regarding the method, I would like to step back a little bit and look at the whole field, which is in terms of the variability of concepts that are involved in the field. If you want to understand any one of these, you will have to project along all the other dimensions. So if you want to look at the Pani or the inherited style, you've got to consider across all the ragas, all the performances by various performers, and across all different composition styles and so on. So it's a very complicated problem, and if you're trying to understand Gamakas, you've got to project along all of these dimensions now. So I took the opposite route and asked the question of what can we learn about Gamakas from one composition set in raga, one pani, which is like one style, and one performer and from a single performance. And the results have been somewhat surprising to me initially. I didn't quite, it seemed possible, but I didn't expect it to be this. And Varnam was a good candidate, and it was also suggested by the previous work on Gayaka, so I just used the same idea. And because it's a rendition of a Varnam is a fairly complex performance, and it's usually about 5 to 6 minutes long, and it provides lots of interesting melodic atoms that you can use to reconstruct Gamakas as a basis for your own interpretation. And also the renditions are usually considered generally austere as opposed to the expressive Kriti forms. So I picked this Varnam in the Raga Sahana, which I'll play excerpts of, transcribed it. So this is the prescriptive notation of the Varnam of the Varnam Karanimpa. So the raw notes are given in it, and as well as the timing information is in there. This is an interface just for browsing the whole for browsing the performance. So. I created this interface just to look at every single pluck and how I can transcribe it, and you can also examine them in slower speed at greater detail just to see what the movements sound like as well. So starting from this, I created a transcription of So the first point in this whole exercise is to transcribe the whole composition into a numeric representation that we can use for resynthesis, and so that we can extract the Gamaka atoms out of it. So the transcription is done manually. So I can, in this interface, I can play it phrase by phrase. So. Pardon the Veena sound because my instrument doesn't match the performance. So and so on. It's a full transcription of the whole performance, and it includes the multi-spill. So it's a complete transcription, and this is what I began. After generating the transcription, which is the first manual step, it decomposes the Gamakas into two components. One which represents a kind of a platform on which the melodic movements are executed. And I'll describe that process a little bit. But I need to go into this representation that I was using from prior to the two component form, which is I transcribed the Gamakas using by paying attention to the quasi stationary points in the curve. A Gamaka is represented as a sequence of these quasi-stationary points along with some timing information around it. So that, I call that representation the PASR form, which is the pitch and time leading to the pitch and time moving away from the pitch and time spent on the pitch. So here's an example decomposition of the phrase. So that's like maga maga marigari rigari mariga. So that's the phrase that's being transcribed here, and I split that into two components, which is that the base for the first part of it, which is ga, and the base for the second part of the movement is in ri. So I take that part out, and then I look at the movement separately. So I just prepared a short illustration of what happens with these two components. So what's interesting is that once you have the Gamaka movement separated out from the stage component, then the amplitudes of those movements get associated with the stage pitches themselves, and that's in almost 90% of the 96% of the cases, what you find is that there's a one-to-one association between them, and only 4% of the cases you find more than one pitch being associated with it. So once that's done, the dance components just, I just call it the dance component. So the dance component just simplifies into three discrete possible directions for the movement, which is, I mean, up, the steady, and then the other component is down, but in this example, there's no down movement. And furthermore, if you look at the timing characteristics, the timing characteristics also simplify into, it turns out to be trimodal, the shape of the movement turns out to be trimodal. So I quantize that into to transient, normal, and sustained modes. And this gives rise to two possible simplified representations, which I call stage R, dance R, and the stage minimal, and dance minimal. So it's what we need to ask is now, which of these representations is makes sense for the purpose of transcribing, purpose of generating a gamma kappa given a prescriptive notation. So this is the basic architecture. You have a local melodic context and a lookup table generated from the local melodic context, which maps to a choice of gammakas, and you pick the gammakas according to what you find from the given prescriptive notation. So in order to understand which representation serves the purpose better, I mean, this is a table of many possible combinations that we can get out of them, and with the entries below the horizontal line, the denominator portion of it stands for duration-sensitive context, and the values above stand for duration-free context information. And our interest is that we want to stay as close as possible to the bottom right corner, but we want to generate the top left corner values from it. And it turns out that we do not require duration information in order to fairly accurately identify which gammaka to pick from the set of possible gammakas in this. So that that operation, what I modeled that using as a DAG. So we have a bunch of gammaka options for each note of the given prescriptive notation, and I find the best path through this DAG by creating a weighting function for each edge that's possible there. And these are the rules that I use for weighting these edges. And the primary two components of this weighting system is the continuity of the stage component, and then the if kampitas are found in the kampita type of gammakas are found in the gammakas, then the continuity of the kampita component as well. The rest contribute a little bit of extra. And overall, what I found was like about 80% of the performers' preferences could be expressed using these simple rules, which don't even appear to be raga specific, which suggests that the stage component captures much of the raga specific melodic aspects of the that are expressed in this performance. So I already summarized that. Do I have time? Sure. Okay. So. Yeah, I'm sort of at the end of it already. So the transcription that's based on I have no idea how to generate the stage dance split automatically at this point. That's one of the major things that were bothersome for me. So I used a bunch of I used the veena itself as a guide. This is a veena performance, and I used the instrument itself as a guide to determine how to gauge the stage component and how to gauge the dance component, because the veena has a sliding dimension and a pulling dimension, and in many circumstances, though, that separation was very useful to judge the two components. So that served as the guide, but as I said, I don't have an automatic way to split these components at the moment. And in the synthesis, if you noticed, the stopping was not very good. The stopping as compared to what was expressed by the performer. So modeling the stopping techniques is also an open problem in this at the moment. And given that we now have a discrete representation for the gammaka that maps onto the continuous forms, we can map edit operations on the discrete representation to the continuous form in possibly some interesting ways. So those are all things that I'm considering at the moment. I'm going to take questions.